There's heroes and there's legends. Heroes get remembered, but legends never die.
It's the Sitting Sportside Podcast, exclusively on 1045theteam.com.
Oh, no!
Because there's no crying in baseball. There's no crying in baseball! No crying!
And welcome in to 1045theteam.com's exclusive presentation of the Sittin' Sportside Podcast. I'm Eric Hanman, and I'm going to bring you today on this podcast, as the title says, my preview of the National League East in the Sittin' Sportside Podcast. As we get going, if you have missed a couple of the other ones already up at this date, you could be listening to this and all of them are up. But as of today, if you're listening to it on the day it's released, March 19th, 2018, the AL Central preview is up and my fantasy baseball preview and value picks podcast is up. There's a Sittin' Sports. If you go to youtube.com/team1045 or 1045theteam.com, there are exclusive links to our podcast, Sittin' Sports on Podcast, all of them sitting on one playlist for you, so just look out for that on those places as well. Here we go. Going into the NL East, I'm going to jump right into it. It's a great division, right? Or not. I think a lot of people look at this division and say, hey, this is a division in the National League that's clearly the worst. It's the Nationals and everybody else, and here we are, your home for New York Sports, 1045theteam.com, the New York Mets. Can they do it, right? That's what we're going to talk about in this podcast. So, my fifth place team, we're going to go from 5-1, and as I've stated earlier in the AL Central Preview podcast, I will not release my wildcard teams until that final podcast, which we're getting down to. It could be any of the other four divisions. It will be the last one in the most recent podcast if you're listening to this closer to opening day. So, my fifth place team is not going to surprise a lot of people, but my take on the team might be a little bit more surprising than some might think. So let me explain. Fifth place team, not surprised to anybody. It is the Miami Marlins, the team that really unloaded in this offseason, trading their starting outfield from left to right. All-star, really, outfield. Yelich, Marcelo Ozuna, Giancarlo Stanton, as many Yankee fans know, and really the whole baseball world does. They're all gone, and now you have a completely different team all the way around. The starting pitching continues to not be that great. And that's, you know, what a lot of people are contributing to this demise and the selling that Jeter has done is because of what happened and the tragedy to Jose Fernandez. Now we're looking at a team that doesn't really have much pitching depth. And so that is where we'll start. We'll talk about this rotation, and Jose Urena is the top of that rotation. Dan Straley's up there as well. It's not going to necessarily get the job done. Yoan Shen is probably their next best option, but he is not expected to be ready for opening day, opening week. Then you get into who else they have. Adrisimer Despaigne, a journeyman who really has had just a 4.5-year right throughout his career. And then the guy really to like in this rotation as someone to really keep your eye out for is Sandy Alcantara. He came over in the Marcelo Ozuna deal from St. Louis along with Magnarius Sierra, who we'll talk about in a little bit, although he's dealing with an injury. But he could still have an opportunity in the outfield. Probably will start the season in the minors or on the disabled list if that hamstring is a problem. And so I think that Alcantara can be pretty good. We've seen what Straley can do on occasions with 3.5 ERAs and whatnot. But overall, that's where this team is really going to struggle, is the lack of really any great pitching on the starting rotation side. I think you look at the bullpen, it's really not that bad. Brad Ziegler is going to close. Kyle Barraclough has been very good as an eighth inning guy. And Junichi Tozawa, towards the end of his career here, I think can still do a good job for them in middle relief. But when I look at the team as a whole, I don't think they're as bad as people are saying. And I'm going to use an analogy here to a different sport. I know a lot of people are saying this team might not even win 60 games, which is still terrible if you were able to get the 60-game mark. I'm going to use the analogy of the NFL in terms of what people expected of the New York Jets. A lot of people came into the season saying, how many points is this team going to score? Are they going to score the least amount of points in NFL history in terms of a season? How are they going to win games? And naturally, they didn't necessarily do that great, but they still proved people wrong. They were competitive enough, and they showed that they were going to be, they were a decent football team. That's how I look about this Miami Marlins team. And there's to not go too far into parallels of NFL, for those of you who may not know the parallels, the judgments of that happened before their roster was really set, before they brought in Jermaine Kearse, a wide receiver, and some other, you know, key positions. And that's kind of the truth here. I think this was kind of said before they made some small, savvy moves to bring in a guy like Cameron Maybin, and then maybe one that they didn't necessarily see or really know about in Garrett Cooper. Now, Cooper's not necessarily guaranteed to start. He might platoon with Justin Bour at first base if they want to put him in the outfield. But I think a big thing that a lot of people are missing as well is the acquisition from that same deal, or that deal with Yelich. This is the Yelich deal. A couple of the deals, I think they've gotten really good pieces. Lewis Brinson came over in that deal, and I think he's got a long-term future that's kind of better than Christian Yelich's, in my personal opinion. He tore up the minors, even though he came up and struggled in the major leagues for the Brewers last season. So if he's going to get everyday playing time for this team, whether it's the top of the lineup, bottom of the lineup, middle of the lineup, he's going to get playing time. And I really like what he can do out there in center field. If he turns it on and hits in the 300s, you still have a good, solid option of Starlin Castro, who's kind of settling in now and saying, okay, this is where I want to be. He has to say that. But this is where I am now. I'm going to be the three hitter with Justin Bour probably behind me. Cameron Maybin as a leadoff hitter, very underrated. He can get on base, steal bases. So add the fact that you have a guy... JT Realmuto will probably be traded, but Brian Anderson having a pretty good spring, 3 home runs, 7 RBIs, and 270 in 20 games. So I like what the offense can bring, especially if they can get Garrett Cooper some playing time, maybe in left field, platooning with Derek Dietrich. I think that could be a possibility. I'm not sure his defense is that great out there, especially in a big ballpark like Miami. I'm not going to spend too much more time on Miami, but I just want to let people know, I think this team is going to be better. I think they're going to win games. I think Mets fans could be like, really? We just lost 2 out of 3 to Miami at some point during the year. But there still is not a lot not to like, and they'll probably will be one of the worst teams, if not the worst team in the league, but not necessarily as bad as people are saying, which isn't saying much, but I think that they're going to be better than this. Oh, they're not even going to win 60 games. Maybe they'll win 62. It's still not that great. But to expect the expectations to not go anywhere with this team, they are what they're going to be. And we're all, you know, we're not going to kid ourselves. That's it on the Miami Marlins. They are who they are. They're not going to be better than, you know, 70 wins. But they're also not going to be this abysmal team that's going to be one of the worst ever. Or I could be eating my words. We'll see. Moving on to the fourth place team, the Atlanta Braves is the one that I'm going to select here. And I actually have a lot of positive things to say about the Atlanta Braves. There's really a lot to like about them. They're young, the talent around this, from Dansby Swanson at shortstop to the Keystone and Ozzie Albies. I really like what they have in that middle infield. You know, the double play turners right there. They could be a staple on this team for years to come and one of the best in the league, not only on the field, but also with the bats. And I really like what they can do as well. They're the person they toss to at first base is probably one of the best in terms of, you know, he's a great fielder, but he can also really hit the ball well in Freddie Freeman. So there's a lot to like there. The outfield isn't too bad. Ender and Ciarte in center, Nick Markakis in right, and maybe Lane Adams and PJ Tucker, or should be Preston Tucker, not PJ Tucker. He's an NBA player. Preston Tucker, the brother of Kyle Tucker, the Houston Nationals prospect that's kind of got a lot of play in that Garrett Cole deal, but didn't actually get traded. He's still with Houston. You know, they both get platoon there with Preston getting at-bats against righties until Ronald Acuna comes up, the high-heralded prospect, the young 20-year-old, and he's like a phenomenon, but he's both. Why can't he be both, right? So if he comes up at some point in May, whenever the clock is right for these managers to bring him up, could have a really good outfield with Ciarte and Markakis as well. Markakis is that guy who's going to hit 270 for you and be a staple, maybe, you know, guy that, you know, sometimes hits 3-4. But when you get this real down in the nitty-gritty with this lineup, he'll probably hit 6 or 7 if you're really getting who you want. The most at-bats, and Acuna and Ciarte, Albies, Freeman. Johan Camargo can have a decent year at third base. So I think their offense is going to be pretty darn good this season, and rightfully so. It's the pitching that they have. They have the pitching, don't get me wrong, but where is it going to go? Is it going to be as good as it can be? And I think Julio Teheran is like exactly the example of what the pitching is. It's what are they going to bring to the table? Are they going to bring this great ERA as you see every spring training from Teheran, or is he going to, you know, not have control? Is he going to have control issues? Is he not going to be the best pitcher he can be all the time, very consistent? Same thing with Mike Foltynewicz. He throws very hard, but he doesn't have enough good enough soft stuff, and he lets up too many fly balls and doesn't strike out enough batters, especially when he throws as hard as Foltynewicz does. So there's concerns there. Brandon McCarthy is a guy that hasn't been able to stay healthy the last couple of seasons, and quite frankly, he's shown what he can do when his cutter is going well, but he's just not necessarily a guy you can rely on every single start as well. And past that, Sean Newcomb has that control problems in his young career. I think the sky's the limit for him as well. If he could have some pretty dominant starts, but as lefties go, he's one of the best young prospects in terms of lefties, but he has some control issues and he can be inconsistent as well. So I think this rotation as a whole, as I said, has inconsistency problems. And if Luis Gohara can come back and be decent as well, they could have a very solid starting five. But to start the season, if it's Scott Kazmir or Matt Weisler, not really, you know, hyped up on that fifth starter, but they can have a solid five if everyone's going right when Luis Gohara comes back. So that is a good premonition, or I'm at a loss for the word here, but it's a good sign, I guess, to say that if this team is all going well, the starting pitchings are all going well. It's true about any team, but I think that this team has the talent as a five, but there's too inconsistent for me to trust. That's why I have them in fourth place. Real quick on the bullpen, I think Aureus Vizcaino is one of the better closers. I think underrated closers. I like what they did in the middle of the relief of getting Chase Whitley and Peter Moylan. So they have a decent bullpen, but it's not necessarily one you're going to write home about at the end of the day. Rex Brothers thrown in there as well. AJ Minter might get closing opportunities at some point this season if things don't work out with Vizcaino. He has good prospects in that bullpen as well. So good bullpen, not great, and the pitching too inconsistent for me. Hitting though, I really like. This is where it gets down to it. The top three teams, I think we all know who's going to be number one, and that's why I think I'm going to do it the normal way. I was thinking about possibly just previewing the number one team now, but let's just go the normal way. And this is where it could get surprising for some people, and I'm going to mix things up. My third place team, and let me just preface this by saying I really like all three of these top three teams, and that's why it's going to be surprising, maybe less surprising now that I've kind of given that preface. I think that all these three teams could really actually compete for the division title. And I'll get to it when I talk about the first place team, why I necessarily think they might not be as good as they were in the past. And I'm going to stop blabbering on. I'm just going to get to the point, right? That's what you're yelling in your car, wherever you may be listening, at home, whatnot. I'm going to get to the point. My third place team is the New York Mets. I'm sorry, Mets fans. I know you're here on your home for New York sports, hoping to get a first place or at least a wild card bid from me. But I had you guys in the playoffs last year, and I can't necessarily, in all good conscience, look at this team and say they're any different than last year, which is why I still think they could make the playoffs, because there is a lot that they can do. Obviously, they've gotten better at third base than Todd Frazier. Jay Bruce is back in right field, so now you have no... he could have been a full season last year if they were in the playoff race, right? So it really comes down to what they have done elsewhere. Not enough in the outfield. They still have Bruce. They still have Cespedes. If Cespedes is healthy all year and they keep Bruce all year, maybe they make a later push that they could have had. If Michael Conforto comes back healthy, I really love the outfield, but there's no guarantee coming back with targeting a May 1st return. And we'll see if it happens, but that's a tough injury to come back from. So the depth, though, I'm okay with Nimmo, but not, I don't love it. Well, Garris has shown he's a good, great defensive center fielder. Great. But he's not going to get the job done offensively. I like the Adrian Gonzalez move, but I also love the fact that Dom Smith is that backup option if he can get that hamstring healthy. Quadriceps healthy. And so I think Gonzo is a perfect lottery ticket. You can buy him and think, oh, he's going to have a bounce back year. So I like that a lot. But the middle infield, with Drivel Cabrera, I still look at like he's been underrated. I'm someone who actually heralds Drivel Cabrera because I think he's underrated. But see, I think a lot of Mets fans would kind of do this with me and be like, But Amed Rosario, I love the kid. I think he's going to be a great player. But is he going to have a great first step this season? We saw it back with that Braves team, Dansby Swanson. We thought he was going to light it up all last year. He didn't do that. He struggled at times. Same thing happened with Amed Rosario. So that being said, I'm not sure the offense is really good enough. And that's what really came down to it for me last year. And with the pitching injuries, if you have one pitching injury, this team could really hit the fan. Because you still had Jacob deGrom a lot last season. And how can I trust Harvey and Matz now? Now I'm moving on to the pitching. Obviously, Syndergaard and DeGrom, love them. 1-2 punch can really go with any 1-2 punch in this division. That includes Scherzer and Strasburg, who we'll talk about in just a little bit. So I still really love the top of this rotation. But can Harvey get back to form? I don't know. Can Matt stay healthy and get back to Matt's form was 2 years ago? I don't know. Harvey's shown more consistency in his career and to me, like by repetitive success than Matt's has. So if I don't have trust in Harvey, I'm not sure I can have trust in Matt's because he hasn't had two great seasons. He's only had that one great year, right? So, you know, and Vargas' injury doesn't really put a vote of confidence in me for that as well with the fracture in the right hand. So, that being said, if Wheeler's not going to get the rotation spot, or Lugo, or Gesellman, who is it going to be? I think it might be Wheeler. Maybe it's Lugo. I don't know. But that's still not the best fifth starter for the New York Mets. And the bullpen has been a mess, and I'm not really sure. You know, Hansel Robles, is he really in the middle of the middle of a relief guy? You have to relieve a pitcher early because he's already up around 100 pitches in the fifth or sixth inning, and you have to pull him out, and you have to go to a guy like Robles. Do I trust him? I used to have high expectations for a guy like Rafael Montero, but can you really trust him? And based on track records, you really can't trust this bullpen outside of AJ Ramos, who I really like. I think Jerry Blevins is actually a really good pitcher. Swarzak has shown splashes, but I still have my worries about him. Same thing with Familia. I mean, you have too much of inconsistency with Familia there as well. So there's a good chance the Mets are a good team, but there's also a good chance that they're still that same Mets team from last year that can't score enough runs, only can hit home runs, and then there could be an injury or continuing lack of success from some of these pitchers. So, and that's Harvey, Matz, and even a guy like Wheeler and Lugo to an extent. So that's why I can't move the Mets any higher, and that's where we get into, well, you can't move the Mets higher, but you have the Phillies higher than them. I do. I had the Phillies in second place, and that's my wrap on the Mets. And you can come at me about any of these teams at the top of the podcast. Like I said, no crying in baseball, but I would love for you to cry to me if you really want to, if you really have to, at EricH1045. So tweet at me there. I would love to hear your two thoughts, especially the Mets fans, because we're your home for New York Sports 1045theteam.com. But yes, I do have the Phillies in second place, baby. Hitters ballpark, and they might have one of the best lineups in all of baseball. All of baseball. I'm going to go that far. If Rhys Hoskins can do Rhys Hoskins from second half the last year things, I absolutely think this kid can do. It can be huge. He had 18 home runs and just 170 at-bats last season, 48 RBIs. So you put him in left field and you bring in Carlos Santana. That's a switch hitter. So he fits into the lineup perfectly. So, you still have the lefties and Nick Williams and then the righties and Michael Franco. And Odubel Herrera is also a lefty. Excuse me, I didn't mention him. And so there's a great balance in this lineup. Not only do you have Hoskins and O'Herrera and Williams out there from left to right, but you have Aaron Altair, who's the righty, waiting to fill in if one of them gets hurt. One of them isn't performing. He can play center. He can play right. He can play left. So he might platoon with right field with Nick Williams. I believe that is the start of the season. So there's a lot to like there. And then the depth past that even goes to Roman Quinn. But I'm not going to get into that far. Across the infield, I think Michael Franco had a good year, a down year last year, but he's still a guy that has a lot of potential, and I'm not sure a down year for a guy who still hit last season, who still hit 24 home runs. I get it. He only hit 230 and was very disappointing. He doesn't walk a lot, only a 280 on base percentage. He can improve the walk rate. That'd be great. But he still hit 24 home runs. He's still got a lot of power. So he still has a lot to bring. Like I said before, I love the acquisition of Carlos Santana. Put him at first base. There is some fielding qualms out there with Hoskins in left field. So, you know, having both those bats in the lineup is great. But I'm not sure how the defense is going to be in left field with Hoskins. In the middle infield, J.P. Crawford. Crawford is long awaited for this guy to get to the major leagues. He can really hit for average. The same worries about Amed Rosario really come to J.P. Crawford. Like, I'm not going to sit here and tell Mets fans, hey, I think Crawford's going to be great, but I still have worries about Rosario. No, I have a lot of concerns about J.P. Crawford. But the thing with the matter of the matter is, Sean Kingery, a second base prospect who's going to start the season in the minor leagues, has a lot of great potential to be a great second baseman. He has been doing very good in spring training. He had at least 4 or 5 home runs. He can fit right at second base. So if you keep Cesar Hernandez and Crawford is really struggling and needs more seasoning in the minors, you move Hernandez to short and you give Kingery a shot. So there's so much depth in the infield, so much depth in the outfield all over. And I love their catcher, Jorge Alfaro, who they got for Cole Hamels in the Cole Hamels deal, along with Nick Williams as well, who's that right fielder. So, you know, Alfaro is not going to hit in the 300s again, but he hit in the 300s last season in limited action. He platooned with Cameron Rupp and company and Knopp, but batted last season at a 318 and hit 5 home runs in 107 at-bats. So the power is going to be there, and maybe the average isn't there, but this is really going to be a really good offense. I think I've spent enough time on the Phillies offense, but that's how much I like the offense. I had to really explain it because I think they're going to be really good offensively. And then you bring in Jake Arrieta, where a lot of people are saying, oh, why is Arrieta going to this team? That's because I feel like the guy has a knack to know who is ready to go. Arrieta and Nola. Nola had a sensational second half. If you don't know what Nola did in the second half, I really urge you to Google it and really look what he did in the second half. He was sensational in the second half last season because he's probably a guy you didn't really hear about a lot. And then past that, Vince Velasquez, I think, is a solid 3 guy. Nick Pivetta and Blake Lively rounding out the rotation is not the greatest thing to get. Pivetta showed some really good flashes down the stretch. The ERA is probably going to balloon a little bit, but he can strike out some players, some batters. As a lefty, so he's the difference in this rotation as being a lefty. And then Ben Lively, he's not really a guy, as I think his last name is kind of ironic, just for the fact that Lively, he's kind of a boring guy. But he still had, in his first year last year, a solid year. A 4.26 ERA. I don't think it's anything to shake a stick at. I think it's a solid ERA. It's not fantastic, but I think it's absolutely solid. But he's not going to strike out a lot of guys. You know, 52 strikeouts in 88 innings is not very good. But I think he's gonna if he improves and continues to get batters out, which is the name of the game. You know, obviously pitching Citizens Bank Park isn't great, but I really like what this team is doing. And Eckhoff, if he comes back from that strained right lat healthy, then I think you really have a solid 4 pitchers, really good 4 pitchers with Velasquez in there as well. And Eckhoff, if he's healthy. And then if whether it's Pivetta or Lively getting that fifth, I think you still have a really good rotation. The bullpen's okay. I really like Hector Neris in the back end, along with Pat Neshek. Mark Leiter Jr., I think, has a good opportunity to be a good middle relief pitcher, or excuse me, long relief pitcher. So I like what this Phillies team has done, as you can tell at this point. And so I have them in second place. Sorry, Mets fans. There's just so much more to like here in terms of the batters. And then you bring in Arrieta. I'm not sure you're going to get 2016 Cubs Arrieta, but man, the 2015, 2016 Arrieta, but I think this rotation has a really good top 2. Arrieta and Nola aren't going to match up with the other 2, you know, Syndergaard, DeGrom, or Scherzer, Strasburg, but they're going to be their own force to be reckoned with in terms of great top 2 pitchers in the National League East. Let's talk a little bit here about the Washington Nationals, who I do have coming in first place. I do have some worries about this team coming in first place, and that's where I think the Mets can sneak in. Mets and Phillies can sneak in. They're competing for this first overall in the National League East. I know they've run away with it the last couple of seasons, but I still think there's some kind of worries with Gonzalez on in the rotation. We know about Scherzer. We know about Strasburg. I'm not even going to spend time on them. I've already mentioned them. Gio Gonzalez had an amazing year last year. I'm not trying to take anything away from Gio Gonzalez, but he had an amazing year last year at, you know, a 2.96 ERA, 188 strikeouts in 201 innings. And like I said, I don't want to take anything away from him, but you're still talking about a guy whose ERA the year before was 4.57. You know, his WHIP 1.34, and the year before that, even though his ERA was still sub 4, 1.42. So I think you're still looking at a guy who kind of had an anomaly last year. Now, he's shown in the past that he can have good season after good season, but I'm not necessarily sure I really can buy in a Gio Gonzalez having another great year. So even if he's still around 3.5, he doesn't give that 2.96 ERA, 3.5, 3.8. Past that, you have Tanner Roark, who had his worst season last year, and he's just getting older. Now, that doesn't mean he can't have a bounce-back year and put up an ERA similar to he had in 2016 at 2.83 as opposed to the 4.67 he had last year. But there's still some concern there. And that being said, your fifth starter, A.J. Cole, I don't have much faith in A.J. Cole as your fifth starter. And a 3.81 ERA and 8 starts last season and 11 games total and 52 innings pitched. But I still don't have enough faith in him as my fifth starter. So there's still a lot of concern for me past the top two, but they still have the top two. That's why I have them winning as many games as they are, probably because the top two, Strasburg, Scherzer, they're really good pitchers. Scherzer can win his third straight Cy Young Award. I really think so. So the options around the for the batters still are great. I mean, Adam Eaton, if he comes back healthy, he's an underrated guy maybe coming into this year for fantasy or just in general, because the fact of the matter is, he's coming off a really tough injury last year, but he's going to come in and he could be a really good on-base guy right at the top of that lineup. We've already known that he was very good in Chicago getting on base, so he could do it again right now and get in front of guys like Bryce Harper, Daniel Murphy, if his knee is okay. Ryan Zimmerman, can he have an aberration again this year and continue off of what he did last year? I think that's another reason why I'm a little skeptical, because the jury might be still out on whether Ryan Zimmerman can do what he did last year. Can he really, in 2018, do what he did in 2017 and bat 303 with 36 home runs and 108 runs batted in? I really don't know if I can really expect that. I think that's a little much to actually expect. But if he's anything a little bit less, then I think they're fine. Bryce Harper is going to be Bryce Harper. Anthony Rendon, a great third baseman. Shortstop Trey Turner, he's great. And like I said, if Murphy, so you have a really good infield, because if Murphy's good, that's a really good third to second. Center field, if Michael Taylor doesn't really add to what he did late in the season last year, he was great in September into the postseason. So if he continues to do what he did there, I think you're looking at a fantastic lineup, probably right along the lines with what I'm feeling about the Philadelphia Phillies in this podcast. So that part is good. And even better, if he doesn't really hold up to that end of the bargain and he's really struggling or gets injured, yeah, Victor Robles, another phenom, to go along with Ronald Acuna in this division. A lot of themes in this division. Top two pitchers, phenoms and Robles and Acuna, and really good lineups in what I think the Phillies and Nationals are going to be this year. Bullpen's okay with Sean Doolittle, Ryan Madsen, Brandon Kinsler, and Kota Glover, and Sean Kelly. Those are all great pitchers, but they have all had their struggles as well. So the lack of a dominant closer, not that Sean Doolittle is anything, he's not bad. I don't think he's a terrible closer. But I think, last year, 2.4 ERA, solid for a closer, 31 strikeouts in 30 innings in his time with Washington. I think it's good. But the lack of a dominant and big-name closer, I think, could hurt them. Could go out and trade for one. Who knows? That's what they seem to be doing every single deadline. But if Doolittle can shut it down, or maybe they go to Madsen, I don't know. They've been good, but they still, tweet at me if I'm wrong, because I still don't feel like I have this dominant closer in Washington, but Doolittle or Madsen, I think, could hold it down. Kinsler was actually decent as a closer in his time in Minnesota as well, so you never really know. Do I have the Phillies in the playoffs, though? That's the question. Go listen to the last preview podcast when it's up. That should be up by opening day, obviously, so by next Thursday. That would be March 27th that will be up, and I'll let you know my wild card team. So right now, it's either it could be the Phillies. And if I have two in there, it could be the Mets as well. So tune into that one. Get my MVP and Cy Young picks as well. That will be in the last podcast of these previews. And there's only four more left to do. And if you're listening to this in late March, there should be a lot more up there. So I really appreciate you listening to the Sittin' Sportside podcast. Me, Eric Hanman, previewing the NL East. Let me know what you think about the podcast and my predictions on your team, or just if you have a different opinion, at EricH1045 on Twitter. And tune into other Sittin' Sportside podcasts on YouTube.com/Team1045. There is a playlist, and you can also access it on 1045theteam.com under the tab of podcast and click on the Sittin' Sportside podcast. So I'm Eric Hammond for the Sittin' Sportside podcast. I can't wait for the season to start. Thanks for listening.